Craig, well, let me just first off just say it's a pleasure to meet you and to talk to you in person. I've listened to your voice for 23 episodes of the Slycast, so it's a pleasure to talk to you, my brother.
Oh, same here, man. It's very cool, and this community is great. It's so awesome how it's grown.
Have you talked to Chris in person? He says you haven't, I guess.
Nope. No, this is the first time.
Yeah,
and I totally second that. It's really the Slycast thing was what kind of gave me the inspiration to do mine in the first place. I'd have to bow to you guys.
Well, that's very kind of you, Chris.
Yeah, totally. And you've contributed, I think, to a couple of Slycast episodes. I think you sent in some emails, didn't you?
Yeah, I know specifically for the Rocky 40th anniversary.
Right.
Yep.
That's awesome.
Now, I don't know how you guys want to do this. I kind of envision that we could all take the same file and just share it with our respective podcasts, kind of a way to cross-promote and rub each other's back on our respective podcasts. And I think it's kind of cool to have the three different hosts of the three different podcasts talking and cracking wise about Stallone and Rocky and whatever we want. So I don't know. And I thought it'd be kind of cool if we like asked each other questions. Go by the seat of our pants. What do you guys say?
Yeah, I'm down.
Now, it's late for you guys. This is crazy. Are you guys going to be okay?
I'll be good. I probably got an hour before I'm going to have to tap out and go walk the dogs and take care of some other stuff before bed.
Okay, well, totally understandable. Thanks so much for everyone for just being here, and let's get to it. So I'm going to start with you, Craig. You're kind of the what would you call it? The forefather of the Stallone. And I'll tell you my little story about how I came into your world. I've loved and enjoyed podcasts in general for a couple of years now. My brother Ruben, he started his own podcast called The Always Hungry Podcast. And I was like, man, he's doing a really good job. He's having fun doing this, and I would like to do a podcast. But what the heck can I talk about? Called him up, said, I got an idea. Let's do a Stallone podcast or a Rocky podcast, because that's something I could talk about forever without any prep. And so he joined me as co-host. But before I made the podcast, I quickly did an iTunes search of Rocky podcasts, and there wasn't any. But of course, the Slycast came up. I'm like, dude, these guys, somebody beat me to it. Of course, somebody beat me to it. So I never listened to your podcast until this year, the last couple of months. For two reasons. One, because I was scared. I was scared to hear what you had to say and how you guys covered the topics that you covered. And two, I also didn't want to be, I didn't want to copy. I didn't want to copy any of the ideas or formats that you guys had. And so after I'd done about 60 plus episodes, I said to myself, well, it's about time I gave the Slycast a go here. I think I'm comfortable enough. And I was right about one thing. You guys are better than us.
different.
No, I know. But that's my self-depreciating humor. But anyways, yeah, you guys are awesome. So anyways, that's my little background view. And then for Chris, my background for you, same idea. I saw you, your big fan page. You're able to grab so many pictures and background stuff. And you had a lot of followers on your page. Like, holy crap, how are these guys doing it? Listen to your podcast and your voice of radio. It's a
voice of radio.
well, you have a voice for radio and a face for radio. But I always say I have a face for a podcast. So I don't know if that's worse or not. But but it's just been great to get to know you guys. I enjoy your guys' shows. And so, Craig, why don't you tell us a little bit about why you started the Slycast?
Yeah, it's pretty amazing. And first, I just want to take a minute to say that there's been a lot of challenges over the last probably 2 years with the Slycast, and it's been great to see other alternatives pop up in terms of, for people to listen to people talk about Stallone. Because when we started, the only other person that was really doing a regular discussion was Matt over at Rambo Mania, who's just put out some incredible, incredible content. It's just been great to see that, there've been other people that sort of have picked up the baton from us while we sort of got into low gear and sort of continued to pump out content that people could enjoy. So I just want to say big ups to you guys for what you've done. I know you've put out many more episodes than the Slycast, Ryan. Kudos on that. I know how challenging it is to put out a podcast and the amount of work that goes into it. So I just wanted to take a minute to make sure you guys got the appreciation you deserved.
That was very kind. I
appreciate that.
So yeah, I mean, the wild thing with the Slycast was I've done a couple of different podcasts in the past, and I used to guest a lot on a podcast network called the Adventure Club Network, which my first podcast ever was on, called Camel Clutch Cinema, which was about movies about wrestling or that had wrestlers in them. And we did about, I think, almost 90 episodes of that.
Wow.
We put out 90 episodes in a row. We never took a week off. And that was including a period where we didn't have power for about 12 days after Hurricane Sandy.
Oh, wow.
So I was talking and kind of joking around with Jeff Ferry and Jeff Hewlett about how, you know, nobody ever really gave Stallone his due in terms of analyzing his career. And I did this a similar search to what you did, Ryan, and I was amazed to find that aside from people like doing a random Rocky episode
right,
on a
movie right.
podcast, or Cobra, which I think is probably one of the most covered movies in podcast
yeah,
history.
Yeah, it is. Weird.
I was amazed that nobody had dedicated a podcast to Stallone. So our original intent was to do, like, I think 14 episodes over the course of a year. And that's why, if you listen to the show, those first couple of episodes, we like blow through movies. I think that first episode, we covered everything leading up until just before Rocky.
Right.
But then two things happened. We were having so much fun talking about Stallone and his career in these movies. But then also we got this amazing response from people that were listening. We got emails and Facebook messages and tweets from people all over the world. And that's when it really hit us, you know, how much of an impact Stallone really has globally. I was able to connect with Matt from Rambo Mania, which was a great, he's become a really good friend. And then also we
awesome.
Were able to connect with Mike Kunda,
yeah.
who is also just an amazing, amazing person who is really about to blow up, with his documentary coming out.
Yeah.
You know, we kind of hit a couple of rough patches when I moved out west here. I moved to Las Vegas in the summer of 2015, and with the time difference,
right,
and just everybody's life, it just got harder and harder to do the show. But it's something we're still committed to. We're still planning on pumping out new and fresh content, and there's still a lot of Stallone movies I want to talk about.
Oh, yeah.
Unfortunately, we're going to have to get through some pretty bad ones before we talk about the ones that we want to talk about.
Well, sometimes the bad ones make for fun episodes, though. And yeah, like
Ryan, if you guys want to come in or take over for the Avenging Angelo episode, please do.
Oh, that'd be great. I would love to. I will guest host at any time. Any time, brother. I'd love to come on and guest host on that show.
Excellent. Excellent. Yeah, so that's pretty much you know, my history.
And you're also doing a Star Trek? Is that still going on? Or?
Yeah, that's one that I'm not as involved with anymore. But
okay.
me and Jeff Hewlett, he wanted to get into podcasting, and we sort of brainstormed an idea, and Star Trek is another one where there's like 8 million Star Trek podcasts. You
sure.
know
oh, God, yeah.
But we found a really unique way to cover Star Trek, and that was to do a scene-specific commentary for every episode of the original series. So we did 80 episodes of that where, you know, you can put on the Blu-ray or the DVD, or I don't think it's on Netflix anymore, CBS Access, I guess.
Right.
And you can watch along to the episode and hear us talk about it. That was an incredible amount of fun. It really, really made me appreciate Star Trek on a whole nother level, which Star Trek's a show that I've loved since I was a kid. To be able to do that and to just sit down and sort of really put a critical eye on those episodes and, you know, look at what they were trying to do thematically and the messages they were trying to tell. Or the messages they were trying to deliver and the stories they were telling. So once we finished the original series, you know, Jeff had a lot of ideas about where he wanted to go with the show. So he's sort of been piloting or captaining the ship, if you will. And now they've got episodes dedicated to the comic books. They do a series called Trek Ranks, where every episode they pick different topic and they rank the five best or worst. They've also recently started covering Star Trek Discovery. So yeah, that's an active. I think it's become a network at this point. But,
oh wow,
that's another podcast that I'm really, really proud of. And like I said, if you have any kind of interest in Star Trek and have the ability to watch those original episodes, I think people would really, really enjoy those.
Now, Mr. Chris, talk about your podcast scene.
I was doing a Google search for something Stallone related, and that's how I actually came across Slycast. I remember downloading and listening to the Over the Top episode, the Rocky V episode, all over the course of a weekend. There was like four or five episodes that I downloaded and listened to, and then I kind of got to where I was, you know, trying to find out who these guys were that did this podcast. And that's how, where I discovered Mike Kunda. You know, I was like, wow, you know, this, look at this guy. He looks just like Rocky. It's crazy, you know. And then what was really cool about Craig, you know, being the sort of at the helm of the show, is not only is he a Stallone fan, but he's also a Kiss fan. So it's like,
oh, there you go.
This guy's like, he's like a soul brother. You know what I mean?
Chris, did I ever tell you that in the womb I was at a Kiss show?
No.
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah, New Year's Eve, 73 into 74. My dad took my mom to see Blue Oyster Cult at the Academy of Music. And, you know, as you know, Kiss opened that show.
Yeah.
That's the show Gene, I believe, caught his hair on fire.
Hair on fire, yeah.
But yeah, so my mom, she wasn't really in the venue too much. I think she was half inside and half outside. But I've always been able to hold it over my brother's head that I was at a Kiss show first.
That is awesome.
That's hilarious.
I went to a book signing when Nothing to Lose came out. Gene and
Paul were
doing one in Staten Island. And it's funny, if you see my copy, I'll send you a picture of it, Chris. If you see my copy of it, Paul's signature, if I posted that signature on the FAQ, probably 99 out of 100 posters would say it's fake. And
yep.
It's because while Paul was signing my book, I was telling him that story. And he was like utterly amazed. Like he was really, really sort of, impressed by the fact that I, you know, before I was even breathing air, I was at a Kiss show.
I'll bet there's not many people that can attest to that, especially that show. I mean, that's like wow. The start of the whole thing, you know?
Yeah.
That's pretty cool. That's really cool.
So, yeah. So I, you know, I was instantly attracted to Slycast. It was just a great format. I didn't see anybody else doing that kind of a show, and I thought that was really cool. And I had already started Stallone Fanatics, the Facebook group, by that point, but that was still at that point where, you know, we had like 70 members, and I thought, yeah, there's got to be more people out there that are Stallone fans. I don't understand why more people aren't clinging on to this stuff. And then it just sort of carried on through until Creed came out, and then all of a sudden everybody was, you know, sending a friend request to Stallone Fanatics. That's when I met Matt. From that point forward, we became friends, and he was on me from pretty much day one to either get on a podcast with him or to start a podcast of my own. And it was just, at the time, there just wasn't, I didn't have a lot of spare time during that period. It just didn't seem like something I was going to be able to devote much time to. And I thought, you know, we already got Slycast. What more do we need, you know? And then it just organically sort of happened where, you know, I found CastBox. I found it was an easy host site for podcasts. You know, I had these three Facebook pages or groups. They had the Kiss group, you got the Stallone group, and then I got this Retromania. And I thought, well, I might as well just do a podcast for each one of them. I'll just figure out what I'm going to do as I go along. Matt sort of christened himself as my co-host, and it's been cool. I mean, we've had a good time with it. You know, he's very technical at times, maybe too technical, but you know, that's Matt. But I love him to death.
And yeah, I love it. He's always got an alternate scene or deleted scene. He sent me a message today because we just started Rocky IV season 4 on the Rocky series podcast. He sent me a message. Oh, you got to get me on. I've got all these deleted scenes. It's like I'll try. I always get him on. He's been on every season he's been on, and he's very good at telling us what we've missed or what Stallone didn't film or should have filmed. And yeah, he's awesome.
And then guys came along in what, April of 2015?
16. Yeah, April 2016. Oh, 16. Yeah.
And so I saw you guys came on, I was like, I got to get my head out of my ass and I got to make something happen here because I feel like I was missing the bus, you know? So in June is when I started it. And it, like I said, it was just sort of a ham and egger, as you like to say. And, you know, it just sort of progressed from there. And it just, and going back to like what Craig said, this community of Stallone fans and the people that are doing these shows and have these groups. I mean, it's amazing. It's just, it's nice to see Stallone getting his due.
So, yeah. Craig, what are your thoughts on Creed 2? Because we haven't heard that on your show yet, of course. I remember, it's funny, because I was listening to your Slycast, and it's kind of fun to listen to you guys talk about Creed. I haven't already seen it, but hearing you guys talk about it, when it's about to come out, and your thoughts about it before it came out, I was excited to listen to, oh boy, I wonder if they're going to like it or not. So what are your thoughts then on Creed 2? What are your hopes? What are your fears?
I'm really glad they're making another Creed because, as you know, we all really responded to it, to that first film. My hopes for it are it's a worthy sequel. My fears are that Stallone having majority of the creative input is maybe going to take the series in a direction it doesn't necessarily need to go. And what I mean by that is, you know, we reached a point with the Rocky movies where with part four, it sort of peaked in terms of almost existing in another universe.
Yeah. We talked about that. Yeah. In our last episode, it's almost a sci-fi action movie.
Exactly. And then, you know, Rocky V sort of brought things back to Earth. And then, of course, Balboa, which was perfect wrap up for that series.
Right.
And then we got Ryan Coogler convincing Stallone to bring Rocky out for one more movie. I think his approach to the story was really great. There's all those parallels to the first Rocky movie. My fear really is that Creed 2 shouldn't be a story of revenge. It should be really a story about forgiveness. And I would love it if somehow the story found a way to have Creed connecting with Drago, but on a level where he sort of forgives him for killing his father and then proceeds from there.
I can see that.
Yeah.
I agree with you, Craig. I think a lot of people think it's going to be a revenge film. Revenge of Adonis, let's say. Adonis never knew his father. I wonder if Paulo didn't die, he was still going to be born a bastard child, but they were going to take this guy, and he was from an illegitimate affair. The death of his father, it might have been better for him, but having never known his father in person, I don't know what kind of revenge factor. The only thing that he was concerned about Creed Part 1 was that he wasn't a mistake.
Right.
He never really expressed, I can't recall, but he didn't really express knowing or wanting to know his father so much. He was curious, but I don't think he was heartbroken about it.
Mm-hmm.
What about you, Chris? What do you think?
I have high hopes for this movie, and I think that there's a faction of fans that want to see this whole Adonis versus Drago, you know, revenge thing. And I believe that those are the fans that lean toward Rocky IV as being their favorite movie. And there is a lot of those fans out there.
Yeah, it's box office. Yeah. It was the most popular one.
Yeah, but I feel like you know, when you and I talked with Mike not that long ago, and he kind of feels the same way as Craig, and I. You know, my feeling is that while history has shown that Stallone, you know, has a tendency to go that camp route a little bit, I feel like Ryan, not only invigorated the franchise, but he also reinvigorated Stallone. Right.
My bad. Mr. Coogler. Oh, how dare you.
Yeah, Coogler.
Okay, all right.
So I feel like maybe, you know, Stallone sat back, even though he was in the movie and very highly involved in the project, I think he sat back and he watched Ryan work. And I think, you know, that may have had an impact on him, kind of taking him back to the root of all of this. So I feel like this many years later, having made some mistakes and realizing them now, my hope, and I lean toward the idea that he will take this in the direction that we really want to see him take it. I'm not too fearful about it.
I was going to say that the most exciting thing here for me, and we talked about it a lot on the Slycast, is we've all collectively sort of thought that Sly never really got to flex his muscles as a director. So that's really the most exciting thing here, is that we're going to get another movie directed by Stallone.
Yeah, I'm excited for that part too. My only fear is with this film, of course, the obvious, the campiness issue. But I think I think we're past that. That was an 80s thing. I don't think we're doing the campiness anymore. Rambo Part 4 kind of showed us that he's not doing it. Rocky Balboa showed us that he's not doing it. So I don't think we have to worry about that. I think it's going to have the same drama, not darkness, but seriousness. I think he's more wise now as a director. He showed that his cameo appearance on the show, This Is Us, that he wants to be serious. But yeah, my only fear is that it's going to be short. Creed was 2 hours 15 minutes, and it didn't feel long. I mean, that's okay.
Yeah.
Moviegoers don't need short movies like Rocky III, or, sorry, Rocky IV. What made that movie not as good as it could have been was it was so short. Like, why
it was all
did
montages.
It, well, that, yeah, it was a montage plus a little bit of dialogue, then a montage, then him yelling Drago, then a dance scene, and then fighting. And but it's a fun movie. It's a fun watch.
I remember reading in one of Leonard Maltin's movie review books.
Right.
I looked up the Rocky movies, and under Rocky IV, he said, I think he gave it like a 1.5 stars, and he said it was a 90-minute MTV music video.
Yeah, that's a clever enough synopsis. I mean, Rocky IV, it's a lot of fun. It's like empty calories, though.
Yeah, I think Craig hit the nail on the head talking about of Rocky getting Adonis past the revenge part of this. I don't really think it's going to end up being an 80 or 90-minute movie. I think because there's going to be a couple of subplot in this movie, yes. I think that it's probably bound to be a 2-hour film.
Yeah, and I don't think Drago's a big part of it. I think we might set ourselves up, or fans might be thinking it's a huge part of it. It may just be a meeting. It may just be I've got bigger fish to fry in my life. I'm going for the champion. I'm going for the belt.
Right. Mm-hmm. I feel the same way. I think people, like I said, there's a lot of people who want to see a lot of Drago in this, and I don't think they're going to get exactly what they're looking for with that. I just don't.
Yeah. Now I'm a little behind probably on the scoops related to this movie, but I know that after Creed came out, Sly had sort of hinted about the possibility of bringing Apollo back via flashback. Now I think he sort of equated it to like Godfather 2, where you've got two stories moving at the same time.
Yeah. Have you guys watched the show This Is Us, the one that he guest starred on?
It's on my DVR. I just haven't watched the show, so I didn't feel like dropping into the middle of something.
I actually started watching the whole series from the beginning, just so when I watched his cameo when it aired, I'd be good to go. That's how dedicated I am. But it turns out it's a great show, so it was a bonus. It's a fun, great show. And they do that for the whole series. It's flashbacks, flash forwards. And so I wouldn't be surprised if Stallone, in that Godfather 2 kind of way, does the very same thing, as we see scenes that maybe he should have filmed for part 4, and now he's getting his own personal redemption as a director and writer and putting those scenes in that Creed 2.
Or even better, maybe some cutting room floor stuff that was from Rocky 4 that ends up in Creed 2.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, with de-aging of CGI now, they can do that.
Yeah.
Clint Eastwood could play his cowboy self again.
That's right.
So let's move on to, because of course, three of these podcasts are Stallone podcasts, not just Rocky podcasts. So we'll cater to those audiences here. Craig, what are your thoughts on the Escape Plan film?
I really enjoyed that original Escape Plan. I thought getting the pairing of Sly and Arnold so many years later, I think it sort of achieved what I hoped from it. I mean, of course, you're not going to get these guys in their prime, but I thought it was a really entertaining movie that I actually saw at a drive-in here in Las Vegas before I moved here. I was here on vacation when that movie came out. So I got to watch that at a drive-in, which was just amazing. And I think Arnold did amazing, some of the best acting of his career. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, that one scene where he's sort of in that solitary where he's yelling stuff in German.
He was actually speaking English. We just didn't understand him.
Get to the chopper.
Yeah. You know, I've sort of been a little confused with the fact that they've shot what now, Chris? They've shot two sequels?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, and they have a release date for Creed, which they haven't even started shooting yet, Creed 2, but they have no release date for Escape Plan 2 or 3.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's two reasons why they did that. It's probably cheaper. They got all the cast and crew kind of already together. Look, Stallone's not getting any younger.
Yeah, well, those movies are going to play huge overseas, and I'm pretty sure that's where Escape Plan made most of its money. I mean, I wouldn't be shocked if by part 3, as much as it pains me to say this, we sort of get a straight to on-demand or DVD.
Maybe. I hope not.
And then maybe a very, 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 very limited theatrical release. I think any time that Stallone's able to do something that's high profile, where he's not playing Rocky or Rambo, it's a good thing. And I always look forward to those movies because you're not entirely sure what you're going to get.
I've been watching the Escape Plan stuff pretty closely, and it seems like Escape Plan 2 is going to be sort of a futuristic sci-fi type thing. whereas part three seems to be more along the lines of kind of what the first movie was like. Not only that, but it was also shot in the same prison where they shot Tango and Cash, which I'm way more excited for three than I am two at this point. So, right. You know.
Is Batista in part two?
I haven't seen anything about him in part three, so I would have to assume no, because he's released all kinds of pictures and videos from the shoot on three, and I have not seen Batista at all.
So I think Stallone's kind of what he's done is he's kind of hooked up with big stars. So you got Batista, of course, he's big for the Guardians of the Galaxy and his wrestling fans. And then, of course, Arnold in part one. The big draw was to see those two together. And I think part three is just like this Asian guy. It's like a famous action star across seas. I think they all play out like a Mission Impossible. I think that's what they're kind of like. They're not necessarily escaping prison each time. The escape plan is just they probably get into tight spots in parts two and three and they escape them.
Yeah.
Like he's like an escape artist or a getaway artist, or he breaks in and out of places. I'm not too sure.
Yeah, there hasn't been a whole lot of reveal on plots for either one of those, just sort of what you see in pictures and videos. All you can really do is just put assumptions together from that. I think it'll be interesting to see both of them, but I'm much more excited to see three and to see if there's anything recognizable from Tango and Cash.
Yeah. Maybe we'll get another butt scene. Stallone, 72-year-old.
Genetics, Pee-wee.
So he's also got a TV movie coming out. Amerta, am I saying that right?
Oh, is that the Mafia-based one, right?
It's an American crime boss, Raymond Aprile.
Yeah.
You know anything about that, guys?
I haven't heard much about that. That one, is it Scarpa?
This one's called Amerta, and it's actually directed by Antoine Fuqua.
Oh, wow.
That's not based on the Mario Puzo book, is it?
Yeah, he's got one of those.
That might very well be.
That is the one. That's right. That's okay. Mario Puzo, the writer of The Godfather. So speaking of The Godfather, this is great because I actually want to talk about this. We need to see Stallone in a true mafia movie. Playing a bad guy. It worked for De Niro. I think Stallone's long overdue to play a bit of a badass.
He dabbled with that early in his career before Rocky. You know, he was in Capone. And
in Death Race 2000, where he played Machine Gun. Yeah,
exactly. So, I mean, it's definitely in his wheelhouse. And apparently he was turned away from Godfather because he didn't look Italian enough or something. So, which is weird. But, you know, I think that would be great. I think that's a really good direction for him, especially at this age. You know, he doesn't have to be so physical in that necessarily.
The other one's coming out is Scarpa. And this one's written by Nicholas Pileggi, the guy who did Goodfellas, the guy who did Casino. Did Casino, Goodfellas, this writer. So this is no slouch either. So this could be two movies right here, like back to back, that could just really be something for Stallone here. To play two mafia guys, it's pretty cool.
That'd be mind-blowing.
This is probably the echo effect, that, you know, a direct result of the work he did on Creed. And I know when Creed came out, we sort of talked about on Slycast where we thought he should go. And those type of roles were the ones that we really thought he should pursue. And Creed, if anything, it reminded people that he is a credible actor.
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. And even me as a big Stallone fan, I was legitimately impressed and surprised. Like, yeah, this guy can really do it. The performance surprised even the hardest of Stallone fans. I think a lot of us came out impressed and surprised again about what he could deliver. And the other film that he's got on the go here is, and I remember hearing about this one, it's called Tough as They Come. It's a true story.
Yeah,
that's about the guy Travis Mills, a soldier in Afghanistan, loses four limbs 4 days before his 25th birthday. So it's about his life after with prosthetics and everything. And Stallone's actually directing that one.
Yeah, I heard there was also a chance that he was going to play the guy's dad as well.
Yeah, that's true. And Adam Driver, the baddie from Star Wars, is the guy who loses his limbs.
Yeah.
I actually would prefer not to see Stallone in front of the camera if he's behind it, except for Creed 2. And I mean, I don't want to call it a distraction. That was the most interesting thing about watching that Statham movie with Franco.
Homefront?
Yeah, that Sly wrote.
You
know, that's actually a good movie.
It is. Yeah. It really is. And that was one that I was like, man, if Sly had written and directed it, it would have been such a good addition to sort of his filmography. That was a movie that watching it, you could feel that it hit some of those Stallone beats that we're used to. And I know it was based on a novel, but still, I kind of like the fact that we weren't distracted by seeing him. And by no means do I not want to see him on film, but I really want people to sort of see what a good director he really is. And I mean, I think there's probably a lot more of his directing work out there than most people are aware of, especially if you believe the rumors about Cobra, First Blood Part 2, and his relationship with George P. Cosmatos. But that's, I guess, a discussion for another day.
Actually, a little trivia here. George P. Cosmatos, he is an interesting director. One, he was born in the city that I currently live in.
Nice.
Yeah. He's actually from here. It's weird because he's one of those directors that you have to be kind of a movie nerd to know who he is. But he was born in Victoria, British Columbia. That's exactly where I'm talking to you guys right now. Yeah, he died in 2005. But he directed some of our favorite movies, Rambo First Blood Part 2 and Tombstone.
Oh, yes, with real mustaches.
Yeah.
But what's funny is both in Tombstone and in Rambo First Blood Part 2, he was kind of like overtaken by Kurt Russell and Stallone, respectively, in the directing chair. Even though he kept the credit, both actors took over the directing roles. He just kind of got pushed around a little bit.
If you look at Stallone, it's entirely believable that he would have brought somebody in that he could sort of use as an avatar, if you will, to sort of call the shots that he wanted to call. But the really shocking thing was that after he died, Kurt Russell finally took the opportunity to come out and take credit for Tombstone, which I'm a big Kurt Russell fan, but I thought that was a little, I didn't think it was appropriate. And at the same time, I'm not entirely sure I believe Kurt's versions of things. It's weird because I can sort of believe the Stallone end of that story, but the Kurt Russell end of that story is a little dubious in my opinion.
Yeah, because Kurt Russell's not exactly somebody that is well known as being a director much.
Exactly.
Right. No, he's just known for his hair. That hair in every film.
His hair.
I love Kurt Russell too, but yeah.
And his love of Elvis.
Well, that's actually something I've always wondered about Stallone is, this isn't a slight, because he's worked with a lot of directors that probably kowtowed Stallone a little bit, wouldn't you say? He's a big guy. Like, not height, stature, but I mean, he's Stallone. I've argued that if you were in a room and Tom Hanks walked in, right? So let's say there's like a party or something, some sort of gathering, and Tom Hanks walks in, everyone would be like, oh, Tom Hanks, they go say hi and stuff. I guarantee you, when Stallone, if he walked into that same room after Tom Hanks, everyone would leave Tom Hanks and go talk to Stallone.
Mm-hmm.
He's that kind of star. I think he's just that big of a star that he fills the room, not with his ego, but just with his. He's Stallone.
Just has a presence.
And I think that must translate on the film set. Can you imagine how you must be as a director to say, hi, Mr. Stallone, can I just have you in this scene do this? And he'd be like, oh, you know, I think I should just do this, you know? Yeah, right. It's like, yeah, you got it. So I wonder how much directors have over him or how much he allows. If he's allowing it, it's just what he wanted anyways. I don't know. What do you guys think?
Yeah, well, I mean, and that sort of circles back to Creed and what Ryan Coogler was able to achieve, because here you had sort of this really untested director who had that one, Fruitvale Station under his belt, which I think Sly was extremely impressed with. I think it's a matter of really sort of gaining Sly's trust, if you will. And I think that Sly's the type of person, and unfortunately, I think there was a huge chunk of his career where he didn't have these people around him, but if he has people around him that he trusts and that he's able to take their input and utilize it if it's better than his own, everybody benefits.
That's kind of the fear that we talked about originally at Creed 2 is I just hope whoever is able to bend his ear, he'll listen.
Yeah. And I mean, I know Coogler's really busy with Black Panther and whatever else he's working on, but if he could still... I don't even know if he is, you know, retaining a producer credit, but I would love to see them collaborate on that screenplay too.
Yeah,
no kidding.
Because I'm sure Coogler has notes for Creed too.
Oh, without a doubt.
Well, I'm looking at IMDb, and right now he's not credited for anything regarding Creed 2. Doesn't mean he won't be, but right now he's not.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know. Like it says here, Stallone's writing, directing, and everything. They'll probably have like characters based on Ryan Coogler, which would be kind of interesting to see that in a Stallone or in a Rocky film, because Adonis is the first character created in the universe that Rocky didn't have any. Jesus, Stallone didn't have any credit on.
Wow, that's really interesting. That's a pretty cool stat. If I was Coogler, that's a nice card that you can play.
Yeah, that you added to the Rocky. So I don't want to get.
It's interesting also that this will be I think 9 years, almost 10 years by the time we hit 2018, since Stallone's actually done a direct writing and acting trio. It's kind of a big deal.
What I'm about to bring up, if you guys don't want to talk about it, I can edit it out. With the Harvey Weinstein and the Dustin Hoffman and Kevin Spacey, and I can't think of all, there's a lot of male celebrities, especially the ones that were back in the 70s and 80s, who are getting outed right now. Is anyone else nervous?
Actually, I'm not. And I got to tell you this, Chris, I know a couple weeks ago, maybe over a month ago, on the Fanatics page, somebody was talking about Copland. And I sort of made a comment saying that Copland was really an opportunity for Stallone that was taken away from him because the Weinsteins had sort of made, I don't know if it was a handshake deal with Sly, that they were going to produce a couple of more dramatic type Copland-like movies for him. And then that's sort of right after that, Stallone sort of went to that straight-to-DVD purgatory. So I'm almost wondering if Stallone's not being comfortable with the behaviors that Weinstein exhibited sort of torpedoed his career.
That could be. I never thought of that. Yeah,
I like that story. And I only say this not, of course, as a that I have any suspicions. I don't know how to say this. This is not Stallone I'm talking about, but men, when they're powerful, rich, when they're popular and famous, and when you have all this money, sometimes the only thing you, I hate to say, conquer, that's left to conquer is the opposite sex, so to speak, or the you know, or whatever it is you're into. I know Mike Kunda has said that he worships Rocky, not Stallone. I can separate the actor from the character too, but there's a little part of me that, you know, if you found out that, let's say, you were a Lord of the Rings fan and you found out that J.R. Tolkien was a Nazi, it'd be hard to like the novel still. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah, totally. I will also say this, Ryan. At the height of a lot of people's misbehaviors, Sly was probably in the gym, what, 18 hours a day?
Yeah.
He didn't really have much time to do anything but work out, eat, sleep.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, he was married to Sasha until 85, and I think he was very committed to her. I mean, obviously, his career kind of took the forefront on things. Then he had Brigitte, you know, that was kind of a train wreck. And he went through a short period there where he was dating on and off different celebrities. And
there's no mystery why he married Brigitte Nielsen in her prime.
No, not at all. I think he met Jennifer in the late 80s, but then they reunited on the set of Rocky V, where her and her sisters were extras. Pretty much from that point forward, he was with Jennifer. So I really don't see Stallone being one of those guys like, hey, you know, I want to sit on my casting couch, you know. I just can't see that happen.
No, I don't either. It's just me being paranoid because as a fan, you know, you're just waiting for the next headline. You know, Brett Ratner just got outed, he's getting kicked out of his companies. It's just happening to a lot of men right now, and rightfully so. If they've done this, rightfully so. And I know we're not supposed to, you know, hang our peers by social media, but it's kind of hard to deny when you have multiple women saying what they are about certain men. So let's
absolutely.
Stallone was around during those heydays of stardom. As far as I know, he stayed away from all that the 80s drug use.
Well, it's like Craig said, he spent all of his time in the gym. Yeah. I mean, literally. Yeah. I mean, between making movies and working out, I don't see how he had time for anything else.
Yeah, I think he loved himself more than anybody else.
That's right. He was molesting himself more than he was anything.
Well, I don't blame him. I don't know how he keeps his hands off himself.
That's right.
It's going to come out in the news. Sylvester Stallone sexual assault on himself has been revealed.
He's outing him. He's outing himself.
Yo, I just couldn't keep my hands off myself. You have to understand, you know. Do you think we should just bury Rambo 5?
Honestly, I would love to see a Rambo 5. I think that there's definitely another chapter or two in that series. I think it just was a matter of the right story, and I think Stallone also needs to feel comfortable that people are ready for another Rambo. I think that's why he's been teasing it. I think he's wanting to get the response.
Yeah, I really think that when Creed was coming out, I said, wow, Balboa had such a great ending. I just hope that Creed doesn't take away from that ending. And I feel very, very much the same way about Rambo, because that last Rambo movie, him walking up that long, long, long path to his family's ranch, it was such a great way to end that movie, because it's sort of who was still around for him to go see, and what was America like for him when he hadn't been on American soil in, what, 30 some odd years?
Yeah.
That whole movie was an incredibly moving work, and it's one of the most moving action movies I've ever seen, especially that last 30 minutes or whatever. It's just unrelenting, and it's just really a master class in directing an action movie. So, I mean, my main thing is really, I really, really hope that we can stay away from cliches. And this is another sort of topic, Chris, you brought up on Stallone Fanatics recently. And I know when I suggested it, Matt mentioned that there was a script in the 90s that sort of dealt with something very similar. But I would love to see Rambo sort of versus a militia, a radicalized militia. And I think you could really have it mirror that first movie where you have this one guy against an army in the woods.
And back on American soil.
Exactly. And again, the war has come home again. You could really paint pictures where, like, Rambo realizes that nothing has changed. That series has always been about coming full circle and stuff. And I think there's just way too many opportunities to mirror that first movie and really sort of hit on some of the themes that Stallone embraced from David Morrell's novel. And I mean, that's the thing. I really hope we don't get like that cliched Rambo goes to rescue somebody's kidnapped daughter that, you know,
right.
cartel
is well, yeah.
It's like, come on, that's straight to DVD Seagal.
Yep. How would you feel if Robert Tepper did the theme song for Creed 2?
You don't bring my nemesis Robert Tepper in this discussion, I'll tell you that right now. I don't know, Craig, if you know, but there's a heated discussion about Robert Tepper lately on our podcast. I've been dragging his name through the mud now for about 5 episodes. I expect a call from his attorney shortly.
Now, Ryan, what's your sort of Rambo fandom like?
Oh, it's huge. When Ruben and I named our podcast Going the Distance, it's officially called Going the Distance, the Rocky series. And then we can change it to Going the Distance, the Rambo series. And then we're going to go the Distance, Expendable series, and so forth. So we're going to tackle all the series that he's done first. And then our goal was then Going the Distance, the Stallone films. So that's going to take us into like year 2030 at the rate we're going. But that was the idea. So it's called Going the Distance, of course, a nod to the term in the Rocky films. I wanted to close with a question that I always mean to ask my guests. What would you ask Stallone if you had one question?
Oh, wow. That's a great question. I would ask him, at this point, I would ask him what the real story is behind him turning down all that money for the Rocky script. And I know recently it's come out.
Yeah,
that might have been a publicity thing. And it doesn't change my feeling on that story and how amazing it is that he did what he did. But I'd really like a definitive answer on whether or not that offer was really made.
Yeah, I guess you could do the caveat that whatever we asked him, the truth would have to be told.
That's right.
That's a great question, Greg. I like it. I'd love to hear that answer. Chris, what about you?
Well, that probably would have been mine as well, especially with it being a current topic issue. I would also probably want to pick his brain about some of the – there seems to be at least a handful of people that I've run into on Stallone Fanatics who swear up and down that Stallone was – an extra in a lot of other movies before Rocky. And the word is that Stallone isn't big on talking about what movies he was an extra in prior to being big. So I would love to sit and talk with him and find out if he was in fact in MASH, the movie, and things like that, you know, just to get a clear sense of what his body of work was really like prior to 1976.
Right. That's awesome, Chris.
I would ask, what's the biggest regret of his career?
Rhinestone.
Well, yeah, and I wonder if it'd be something as simple as that. And I wonder, what is the one thing, again, I want an honest answer. What trajectory choice did you make that you wish you could go back
to? Yeah,
that's a good question.
That's good.
I could talk forever for you guys. I know Craig had an hour, and I don't want to go past that because it's late for everybody. Why don't you guys just plug your shows and where people can find you? And Craig, we'll start with you. Just let everyone know where they can find you.
All right, excellent. Well, and first of all, I want to thank you guys, Chris and Ryan, for making this happen. I know this discussion about this was probably less than 24 hours ago. It's a minor miracle that we were able to pull it off, especially considering how chaotic schedules get sometimes. So
that's pretty cool.
Thank you for the opportunity. It's been great. If you're on Facebook, you can find the Slycast on Facebook. And on Twitter, we also have Slycast handle.
I think if you just search it, though, Craig, it comes up. Search bar. I'm a bit of a Twitter fiend, so I know if you search Slycast, it'll come up.
Well, somebody had Slycast when we were looking to make our Twitter. That's,
oh, really?
It's like Slycast Pod or something. And then my personal one, which I'm really active on, and recently I've been sharing a lot of historical information about the Ramones, so if you're interested in that at all,
nice.
My personal Twitter is Mr. Craig Cohen, and that's Mr. with an MR. And I've actually really been spending a lot of my time on a blog that's ramonespinhead.blogspot.com, where I've been doing on this date in Ramones history entries every couple of days. And that's been a lot of fun. I discovered or started appreciating the Ramones way, way too late in life. And I'm sort of trying to make up for lost time. And I'm also trying to spread the word about what a great effing band they were.
Oh, cool. Excellent. Awesome. A lot of stuff on the go there. What about you, Chris?
Stallone Fanatics is on Facebook. The podcast is on CastBox. It's also on Blueberry, where you can download from there much easier than CastBox. And hopefully sometime in the near future on iTunes as well. Yeah, that's about it for us. Shout out to Matt Marchand. I don't want to make. Yes. I don't want to leave him out.
next time we do this, Matt definitely has to be in the rotation.
Yes. That's right.
Absolutely, he will. I really hope to do this again. Everyone that knows, they can find us on Twitter. The Rockies. The best way to find our show, I found, is to go with the Rocky Series podcast, and that will come up. Comes up in every podcast search, every Twitter search, and the Rocky Series podcast. And another self plug for the other podcast that we do, Ruben and I do, The Worst of the Best podcast. That's a fun one that we enjoy. We're about 14 episodes deep in that. And basically what we do there is the public chooses what's the best with their dollar, whether it's the best selling this or the best selling that. And we choose what is the worst from what people have chosen for the best. So that's what we do.
Awesome.
Yeah,
I totally recommend that. That's a great one to watch.
I'm going to look for it.
Yeah, it's fun. And Craig, add me on Facebook, brother. I didn't know your last name.
I definitely will as soon as we hang up.
Awesome. So I get to see if you have a face for radio too. So
I know Craig. Put us on the Mount Rushmore of podcasters.
that'd be a great Photoshop if we could somehow get the our faces, the Stallone Rushmore podcast face.
Yes.
We got to get that done. All right. Well, hey, well, there you go, guys. Well, it's been a pleasure to talk to you guys and meet you guys. Thank you so much.
Same here.
Thank you, guys.
We'll talk to you soon.
Have a great night.
Bye-bye.